In this video, we will discuss second order methods for neural network learning. In second order methods, we use the second order partial derivatives or the loss function with respect to the weights. The second order derivative with respect to the weights gives very useful information about the curvature of the loss function with respect to the weights. By using the appropriate trade-off between the steepest descent direction as well as the directions of low curvature, it is possible to obtain good directions of weight in which fewer steps are needed for convergence. In other words, the main advantage of the second order methods is in terms of their better convergence behavior for certain types of loss functions. So why do we need second order methods? The reason that we need second order methods is that the complex loss functions in neural network optimization often have very complicated topographical shapes in which the first derivative is often not enough in order to make the appropriate steps. In order to understand this point, we will revisit an example that we showed in one of the earlier lectures. This is an example of a cliff which often occurs in deep networks. Here what happens is that the gradient is very gentle for a little while and then it suddenly goes down a cliff. In such a case, if a step is being taken just before the cliff, a small step may not make any progress at all. On the other hand, a slightly larger step might suddenly overshoot the optimal solution in a very large way. This kind of problem arises because first order methods simply do not have enough information to know the appropriate level of movement or even the appropriate direction of movement with the amount of information embedded in them. On the other hand, because second order derivatives contain information about the nature of the curvature of the loss function, they can often perform optimization which is much more effective in these settings. So we will again motivate this point by revisiting an example which I have discussed in earlier lectures. This is the example in which I have shown two cases. In one case, the loss function is a circular bowl, and in the other case, the loss function is an elliptical bowl. Now, note that both of these are convex optimization problems, and they are relatively easy to solve. However, even in this case, because the sensitivity of the loss function with respect to the y-axis is different from that with respect to the x-axis, there is often bouncing in the case of the elliptical bowl. Here, the key point to understand is that the two directions, the x-direction and y-direction, they have very different curvature. And because they have very different curvature, the steepest direction alone does not give you the path of best long-term movement. Because what happens is that as you move along the path of steepest descent, the relative gradient ratios with respect to the two directions continue to change. That is why a lot of steps with course corrections are needed in the case of the elliptical bowl. To further motivate this point, I give another example. This is this kind of topography. It is referred to as a valley. Now here you can see that the curvature along the x direction is high, whereas the curvature along the y direction is quite low. Now, if you are at any point up in the valley, towards the upper regions of the valley, it is generally more advisable to move along the x direction. However, if moving along the x direction often results in bouncing behavior along the valley. It is often more advisable to move along the least curvature direction in this case. So here the gently sloping direction, which has less curvature, is a better direction of movement. In general, what this tells you is that while choosing a direction of movement, one must choose an appropriate trade-off between the rate at which you are descending as well as the level of curvature of that direction. Second order methods are perfectly positioned to navigate this type of trade-off. So second order derivatives work with the second partial derivative of the loss function with respect to the weights. So here a very useful construct is what is called the Hessian matrix. So the way we define the Hessian matrix is to define H, the variable Hij, for each pair of dimensions I and j. The variable Hij is the second order partial derivative of the loss function with respect to the weights I and j. Now, so if you have a neural network with d parameters, you have a d cross d Hessian matrix in which the ijth entry is Hij. Now, let us see how we can use the Hessian matrix in order to approximate a loss function in quadratic form and then use that approximated loss function to perform gradient descent. So imagine you have a loss function LW which is possibly non-quadratic. We can write a quadratic approximation of the loss function by using the Taylor expansion about any point W0. So the Taylor expansion of the loss function at W, about point W0, is given by equation 19 over here. So as you can see, the zeroth order term, that's a constant, that's LW, that's simply the loss function at W0. The first order term simply uses the gradients at W0. And the second order term, it uses the Hessian. Note that the Hessian is computed at the point W0. Now, for this quadratic approximation, one can derive a single step optimality condition from initial point W0 by setting the gradient of this approximated quadratic to zero. So what happens when you set the gradient of the Taylor approximation to zero? Well, the first order term, the zeroth order term, since it's a constant, it disappears. The first order term becomes gradient of LW0, and the second order term becomes the matrix H multiplied by W minus W0. Now, we can simply set the gradient to zero. Note that this is not steepest descent. This is actually an optimality condition which will give you the optimal value of W when you set it to zero. So by setting the gradient of the Taylor approximation to zero, what we get is a single step. We obtain what is called a Newton update, which is essentially W0 minus H inverse multiplied by gradient of the loss function at W0. Now here, we don't need a step size. It is important to note that there's no step size here because this is an optimality condition. We are solving for the optimality condition. The other point to note in this update, the update uses H inverse. H inverse, essentially you can view the Hessian as a way of capturing the curvature of the loss function. And the gradient of the loss function is of course the first order variation in the loss function. So here you have a ratio of the first order to the second order. So there's a trade-off between the speed of descent and the curvature. In this type of approach. So it's trying to pick the optimal direction of movement using both conditions. So let's see what happens in the case of the elliptical bowl where the bouncing behavior happens. Note that in this case, because in the elliptical bowl you have different levels of curvatures in different directions, whenever you start at a point, the gradient direction will be multiplied by the inverse Hessian. Now, if you go back to equation 20 here, what you're doing is that you're taking the steepest descent direction, which is gradient of LW0, and you're multiplying by the inverse of the Hessian. Multiplying by the inverse of the Hessian has the effect of changing the nature of the direction. So in this case, you can see that the steepest descent direction changes the direction of the descent so that you move to the optimal solution in one step. So in this case, you can actually define a basic second order algorithm, but that algorithm has certain challenges. So the way in which the algorithm works is that at each point you approximate the loss function with a quadratic function by using the Taylor expansion, and then you make the Newton update. Now note that making the Newton update is essentially the same thing as moving to the optimal of the quadratic approximation. So you keep making Newton updates to convergence, which is basically the same as saying that you keep solving the quadratic approximation equations repeatedly. But of course, this type of approach faces some challenges. First of all, even computing the Hessian is very difficult because it's a large matrix, a D cross D matrix. Note that the back propagation that we discussed before, it is only for computing the first order gradient rather than the second order gradients. And then inverting a D cross D matrix is even more difficult. Now, there are several solutions that are discussed in the literature for handling these problems. These solutions correspond to one of them is, of course, approximating the Hessian, and the other works with the projection HV for some direction V. So first we will discuss the conjugate gradient method. The conjugate gradient method gets to the optimal of the quadratic approximation of the loss function in D steps, instead of a single Newton steps where D is the number of parameters. So the idea here is that you pick D different conjugate directions. Now conjugate directions have a certain property. This main property is that once you make a movement along a conjugate direction, first you use an optimal step size to make the best possible movement along a particular direction. So you use line search to get the best point along a direction. Now you move, next you move along its conjugate direction. In the conjugate direction, its main property is that it never worsens the loss function with respect to the previous directions. So in the so the conjugate direction has the property that the gradient of the loss function on any point on an update direction is always orthogonal to the previous update directions. So this is a very important property, because if you can, and the proof of this is given in the book, and you can show that the conjugate direction can be defined in terms, the t plus 1th conjugate direction can be defined in terms of the tth conjugate direction using equation 21. Now, if you have a quadratic function, since you never undo the work done in previous iterations, you only need d linearly independent directions in order to reach the optimal solution. So for a quadratic function, it requires d updates instead of a single update of the Newton method. Of course, in practice, you need far fewer than d updates. Usually with a small constant number of updates, you reach very close to the optimal solution. So here I have shown an example of conjugate gradients on a two-dimensional quadratic. So since it's a two-dimensional quadratic, you'll need just two steps. And when you're taking the second step, the key point is a loss function. You never undo the work that you have done in the first step. That is why you're able to reach optimality in just two steps. So this gives us a basic conjugate gradient algorithm, which works for quadratic algorithms only. So first you start off by setting the first conjugate direction to the gradient of the loss function, and then you make an update along that direction. Then you find the next conjugate direction using the previous conjugate direction and the current gradient using equation 21. So that's the same equation I have written here. And then you keep making these updates. Note that in each case, the step size alpha t is computed using line search. So it's very important to choose the step size so that you make the best possible movement along a particular direction. So this is for the quadratic algorithm. For non-quadratic functions, what you do is that you approximate the loss function with a Taylor expansion and perform much less than d of the above steps. And then you repeat. So you will reach very close to the optimal of the quadratic approximation. Then you take the next quadratic approximation and you keep making the steps. Now, one important point is that you can see this update still contains the Hessian. So the question is, how do you compute the Hessian? So the whole point of the conjugate gradient method was to avoid computing the Hessian. The important insight here is that you don't need to compute the Hessian, because here the Hessian only occurs in conjunction with multiplication with vectors. So the product of a Hessian and a vector can actually be computed very efficiently. So if you have to project a Hessian along a direction V, all you have to do, you need just two applications of backpropagation. So you need to apply backpropagation at point W0, and which is where you're trying to find the projection of the Hessian, and you need to perform backpropagation as W0 plus delta V, where V is the direction along which you're trying to project the Hessian. And you take the difference of the two as in equation 23 and you divide by delta. This follows directly from the way second derivatives are defined, that the projection of the Hessian will be equal to what is shown in equation 23. Now, there are other second order methods are also used. One is, of course, the quasi-Newton method. In the quasi-Newton method, a sequence of increasingly accurate approximations of the inverse Hessian are used in various steps. And there are many variations of this approach, and the most commonly used one is what is called BFGS, and it also has a limited memory variant which is called LBFGS, which takes limited amount of memory and it can be useful in many neural network settings. However, as far as the second order methods are concerned, usually the conjugate gradient method is more popular than the BFGS method. Second order methods face their own set of challenges. The main challenge is that of saddle points. Saddle points are points in the loss function topology, which can be viewed as either a maximum or a minimum depending on which direction we approach it from. Obviously, this causes a problem in second order methods which try to approximate a loss function with a quadratic bowl. So for example, if you look at the function fx is equal to x cubed, the point x is equal to 0 is a saddle point. This is because if you approach the point 0 from the negative side, then this function becomes an inverted bowl. On the other hand, if you approach this point from the positive side, then this function becomes an upright bowl. So in the case of saddle points, what happens is that suppose you reach x is equal to 0, then this point is actually a degenerate point. What do I mean by degenerate point? Note that the Newton step takes the ratio of the first order derivative to the second order derivative in the case of one dimensional loss functions. However, both the one dimensional both the first derivative and the second derivative are 0 in this case. Therefore, the update takes on the form of 0 by 0. A second problem is like the problem shown in B on the right hand side, in which you have a stationary point. In this case, you have the function fx is equal to x square minus y square. Whether the function is a minimum or a maximum, that depends on whether we approach it from the x direction or whether we approach it, approach the point 0, 0 from the y direction. So again, 0, 0 is a saddle point. So in this case, again, you will have the same problem that depending on the direction that you approach it from, you will get either an inverted bowl or an upright bowl. Now again, these types of saddle points occur frequently in the region between two hills of the loss function. First order methods are not naturally attracted to these points. On the other hand, this point becomes a stationary point for the Newton's update. So for example, if the Newton's update reaches this point somehow, 0, 0, then making an update leads to no change in the in the current point. So second order methods are not free from their own set of problems. So in certain types of loss functions, one might actually do better with first order methods as compared to second order methods. Second order methods are often used in settings like recurrent networks where topologies like cliffs are more common. So whether you use a first order method or a second order method depends on the topology of your specific loss function.